event is available directly in English or interpreted in Japanese. And as you can see on the instructions here, if you click on the translation interpretation button at the bottom of your Zoom window, you should be able to choose the language that you want to listen in. This also means that later on, when we have time for some questions, if you want to ask a question, if you're on the Japanese channel, you can ask in Japanese and your question will be automatically interpreted into English. And similarly, so you can just use the language that you've selected. The other thing is that this session is being recorded. So please be aware of that and let us know if you want to disappear from the screen. So then can we have the next slide? So for those of you who haven't been to a GFD event before, Global Faculty Development event, we run a series of events and workshops throughout the year. And our goal is really to provide kind of support for education in at the University of Tokyo in languages other than Japanese. So we have a number of programs that might be of interest to you. And I really encourage you to visit our website. You can use the QR code here if you like, or we can put the link in the chat. And if you visit our website, we have programs. For example, we have a LOOK program where we can give you financial support to attend conferences in related to education. We can give you amounts of money to try out new kinds of activities in your classroom through what's called a TASTE program. If you've got speakers that you think would be a great addition to our program, we also have a program where you can propose events and we can help you run them. So please take a look through, sign up, get on our mailing list and get our newsletter and so forth. Just a quick promotion for our next event, which is coming up after this one. So this is, I think that's the... Maybe the date is wrong on there because November. Oh, no, sorry. Don't know what November the 10th is. So December the 8th. Now, this workshop is Effective Transitions from Online to Offline Teaching and Learning. So this is one in a series we've been running on digital tools. Hopefully you might find this interesting and useful, particularly in the current climate. So please join if you're available. And the other request is at the end of the event, we'd really appreciate it if you could complete the feedback form so that we can meet everybody's needs in the future. Okay, so down to business then. So it's my true pleasure today to welcome today's event and to welcome today's speaker, who is Kevin Byron. So Kevin received his PhD in physics from the University of Hull and basically had a long career in commercial research in photonics, so for 25 years. And while he was doing that, he was an honorary visiting lecturer at University of Glasgow and University of Salford, and was elected to as a fellow at the Institute of Physics. And while he was working in industry, he got very interested in education and in particular in creativity in education. And so he was awarded a Nestor Fellowship back in 2002, and he was then able to independently pursue those interests and work together with students across the UK and with the universities in encouraging and teaching people about how to become more creative in their educational and research endeavours. So he's still working as an independent research skills developer, working with a number of higher education institutions in the UK and in Europe. And he's currently a guest lecturer at Leeds University. And I was very lucky many years ago, we've just been discussing this, back in 2004, in the summer of 2004, I met Kevin at a creativity and chemistry workshop in Wales. And we had a very inspiring weekend doing all kinds of creative activities to look at new and exciting ways of teaching chemistry. So I was very inspired at the time. And recently I thought this would be a fantastic opportunity to bring some of that information and ideas to all of you. So Kevin very kindly agreed to come and deliver this workshop for us. So I'll stop talking now and hand over then to Kevin, and I hope you very much enjoy this session. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, Johnny, and thank you, Cecilia, for organising this. I'll just put my share screen on. Can you see the slides?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay, I'll just put that on full screen. And there we go. Great, so welcome everyone. And I'm Kevin Byron, and I want to explore today a whole range of things about creative material, a whole range of topics. And that title looks very ambitious, doesn't it? You could almost give a whole seminar, a whole week seminar on creativity, education, and research. And to lump them all together is a pretty ambitious goal. But what I want to do here is three things, really. I want to, first of all, talk about the nature of creativity. And then I'm going to talk about some ideas. This whole lecture is a kind of a mixture of the old, the new, and the speculative. So I want to invite, at the end of the lecture, discussion on some of these topics, because I'm kind of trying to provoke debate on certain areas that are still not resolved in the world of creative thinking, but also to remind you, or maybe introduce in some cases, ideas that have been around a long time concerning creativity that still haven't found popular application. And in particular, I'll be looking at brainstorming and idea generation. So it's a real mixture here, and I just hope it will stimulate some creative debate as well, because some of these things I'll be talking are still rather open-ended. Without any further ado, I'll get straight on, and I'm going to start in the traditional way of trying to define the terms. So, and all of the time through this talk, I will be leaving questions dangling, if you like, for you to have a think about and question further with your colleagues. So defining creativity is a bit of an international sport. It's been around a long time now, and there are still debates about what we mean by this term. And I've spent a fair bit of time trying to untangle all this. And I've come to the conclusion that when it comes to defining creative behavior, that is, what does it mean to me as an individual when I am creative, that it's an impossible task. But when it comes to outcomes, we can be very clear what we mean by creativity. So if I were to invite you to brainstorm, or just to think up all of the associations that you have with that term, we might find a whole range of ideas coming up. I'm not going to read all of these out, but challenging the status quo, going against the flow, unexpected consequences. All of those words all relate to what is happening in the mind when we're being creative, or what we are reaching out to do, what skills, cognitive skills, we're trying to practice in order to be creative. In other words, to find ideas for other open-ended problems or challenges that we face. And if we were to include visual literacy in this brainstorm, then all of us would probably include the light bulb, which represents it's a ubiquitous symbol of what we mean by creative thinking. We've had a light bulb moment, or a eureka moment, if you like. Now, the thing is about this, that, there's an important point about brainstorming like this, which I'm going to come on to later on when I try and talk a little as clearly as I can about creative behavior. But the point I want to leave here is that it is so varied when it comes to creative behavior. If you ask 30 people to write down what they regard as creative behavior, you will find some overlap, but you'll find a wide variety in the terms used. When it comes to creative outcomes, we can be a lot more clear. And by the way, I'm going to try and bring back this idea of creative behavior at the end as a kind of a resolution to this lecture. But let's just carry on. Creative outcomes can be very clearly defined. These are ideas that are original, or a novel response to a challenge or problem. So if that could be research, it could be a project, and the outcome is new knowledge. Now, in order to try and understand a little bit deeper about what we mean by ideas that are original, Kaufman and Baghetto have published quite a useful model of creativity. They call it the four C levels of creativity. So I'm going to go through each of these four different levels. And the first one they talk about is what they call mini C, or personal creativity. And by that, they're relating to ideas that are original only to ourselves. So, for example, when a child is playing with a Lego kit or some kind of construction materials, they might build a little monster or something. And it's not particularly original in the sense of a general idea, but to that child and probably to the parents, it's a great event that the child has done something original purely to themselves. But the impact of that idea doesn't go much further than the individual. When we go on to the next level that Kaufman talks about, they refer to this as little C creativity. And here, the assessment of the originality is a little bit wider. This time, we're looking at education. So we might be working within a fixed curriculum that the child or the student has to learn. And as they progress and understand the concepts in that topic, that discipline, then they have been creative in terms of their assessment by the teacher. But so again, here the impact is a bit wider, but it doesn't go beyond the classroom. And then the third level of creativity that Kaufman refers to is pro-C, or professional creativity. And this is when we produce original ideas, original work, and this could be in just about any form that one can imagine. Creativity is not confined. We can be creativity in just about every human behavior. So professional C creativity refers to work that has an impact with regard to, say, our professional job. So it could be a design, an invention, a piece of writing, a book, but it goes out into the public, if you like. So the impact is now a little bit wider. In terms of research, of course, the outcome would be a journal paper, say, or a conference presentation. And then the highest level of creativity is what Kaufman has called big C historical creativity. And I've cited two examples here, which are Nobel Prize winners. For example, Saikuru Manabe received the Nobel Prize for Physics. So this refers to work that leaves a mark in history, a permanent mark in history. You could argue that some of the outcomes from professional C creativity leave a mark, but these are kind of major milestones, if you like. And both of these Nobel Prize winners won their accolade for their research on environmentalism. In the case of Wangari Muta, she also was a woman's right activist, and she was the first woman in Kenya, in Africa, to receive the Nobel Prize. And Manabe got the prize for being the first person to show that there was an effect on the heating on the earth, on the surface of the earth, due to the greenhouse effect, or the accumulation of CO2 in the atmosphere. So a very important contribution there. But under big C historical creativity, we could include a whole range of things. It's not just about academic greatness. It could be political greatness, architecture, design, literature, and so on and so on. But these are major contributions to creativity. So those are the four levels. And I just want to take this a little bit further now, using more of the work by Kaufman et al, because they've kind of plotted these different levels of creativity against the context for new ideas and their implementation against social, cultural significance and impact. And I just want to add this, that if we're working in the world of education, we're operating, we're trying to develop little C, we're working up to that level, mini C and little C. And I would argue that Mini-C is not just confined to the activities of children. Whenever we start a new project, we probably start from Mini-C. We start to play. We talk about playing with the idea, playing with concepts, playing with materials. And then something hopefully emerges out of that that could become little C. In other words, we may have learnt and developed ourselves to that, or it may go on to be pro C. It may become a professional outcome. And I would argue that research kind of starts at little C and continues through to pro C. But excuse me. But there are many other outcomes from pro C other than research. But I'm just looking at this in the context of higher education. And so the impact here is on an organization, field, system of practice or market. And then with regard to big C, the comment I want to make about this is that Kaufman has described this as the eminent creativity of exceptional people. And I put a question mark after that word exceptional. Excuse me. Because a lot of big C creativity is the outcome of a discovery. And I want to argue that discoveries are not acts of creativity. They're accidents. Most discoveries are accidental find. You know, one has a surprise observation and then one builds on it. But of course, it does require a certain level of creative mind to be able to spot a discovery when it makes an appearance. We can very easily overlook discoveries. What I want to say here is that there's a certain amount of luck of people working in the pro C level that results in them being big C creatives as well. And having made that great discovery, they often revert back to pro C again, which is where most of us are working most of the time in a professional capacity. Okay. Now, I just want to dig a bit deeper now into creative behavior and talk about the work of Teresa Amiboli. And she is one of the leading researchers in America on creative behavior. And she says there are three components, three behaviors, if you like, or skills or combinations of both that need to be in place for our creativity to be operational. And the first one is pretty obvious, that if we want to be creative in a particular field, then we need knowledge within that field. We need what she calls domain. That field is the domain, if you like. So if we're engineers, our domain is engineering. If we're artists, and it's in the world of art, in whichever form that takes. So we need knowledge, conceptual understanding, information, etc., within a domain, and as much as possible for us to express our creativity within that domain. So formal education is the goal of formal education, to equip us with the domain relevant knowledge and skills. And one of the observations of based on studies of people who express creativity more than others, and I want to argue that we're all equally creative potentially. It's a basic, we're born with it. It's what defines human beings, really, is the ability to be creative in whatever form that takes. But we can equip ourselves to optimize that creativity. And one way to do that with regard to this first point is in what we call crossing boundaries. That is to say, if we are if we're involved in research or doing a project, for example, and it's open-ended, it's not too well-defined, then we can be supercharged with creativity by exploring outside of the domain in which we're working. Some people refer to this as interdisciplinarity, or I'm going to use a more general term, integrated research. So if we integrate knowledge across different boundaries, then our potential, different domain boundaries, then our potential for being creative is multiplied, because one of the mechanisms, one of the forces of creativity is the ability to combine ideas. And I'll be talking more about this later. And if we're a specialist in a particular field, crossing a boundary can be difficult because you know, we need specialist knowledge within that other field. But there's a great deal of benefit from just studying at a non-academic level, the popular magazines, trade magazines, etc., that sort of thing, the popular press even, to familiarize ourselves with as broad a range of knowledge as possible. The more knowledge we have, the more potential we have for being creative with that knowledge. But that's not necessarily going to happen. So this is only the first of three requirements that Amibley talks about. It's necessary, but it's not sufficient to have this knowledge. The second one she talks about is generically talking about creative processes. So as well as having that knowledge, we need to have some skills to mix that knowledge, to mash it up, to combine it, to transform it. And this covers a whole range of learned skills and cognitive skills. And one that I want to mention is developing a tolerance to ambiguity. There's a whole list of these creative processes, but one that's quite important is called tolerance to ambiguity. And what we mean by this is, and this is a learned skill, that's the reason I've brought this one in. When we are involved in trying to find ideas in a project, we have a kind of a shelf life of freshness, if you like. We start to generate ideas, and after we've generated a large number, well, let's say 10 or 20, we can sort of start to think, well, this is great. I've been really productive. I'm going to stop here. And studies, again, have shown that people who seem to express creativity in more a more productive way tend to not stop there. They make themselves carry on. And ambiguity refers to a kind of a state of mind, a cognitive dissonance, where on the one hand, we feel we've been very productive and we've got lots of ideas. And on the other hand, there's a voice in the mind saying, but there must be something better. There must be a bigger idea somewhere beyond. So I'm going to keep working on this. And what the studies have shown is that people who are tolerant to that ambiguity, in other words, it's a sense of tension in the mind. We want to resolve the problem, and yet there's something nagging at us saying, no, there's more beyond. And they've shown that people who tolerate that ambiguity, they stay in that unresolved space longer, tend to produce more and better ideas. So, and it is a learned skill. So in very simple practical terms, if we're trying to solve a problem and we come up with a solution and then we feel satisfied, by all means, record that solution, but then go back to it again and just ask yourself, is there something else here? And even if that feels like we're getting impatient or we're getting tired of it, it's just worth extending your attention just a little bit longer and become familiar with that tolerance to ambiguity, that tolerant to the discomfort of not having a resolved solution. Then more ideas will appear. The second creative process I'm going to mention is by association. I've kind of hinted at this earlier. At the heart of creativity is this learnt skill to join together two pieces of information that haven't been joined together before, two methods, two ideas, two processes. And I'm going to show it later on how you can make this happen. You can force ideas together in order to multiply your creativity. So again, these are the two skills that we can learn to play with ideas. Remember little c or mini c creativity, and try joining bits together and see what happens. And the other really important thing I want to mention at this stage is that in order to be more creative, excuse me, we have to learn to confront failure. The two things go hand in hand. If we're not making mistakes, then we're not being creative. So the more we accept that making mistakes is part of creativity, the more likely we are to develop our own creativity. More on this later on. But in the meantime, this third component that Amibley refers to is intrinsic task motivation, which is a rather clunky academic term for passion. In other words, there is a connection between our state of emotion, affect, and our creativity. If we have a very low level of emotional involvement or engagement in a task, then our creativity is very low. And if we have too much emotional engagement, then our creativity drops again. So there is an optimum level of engagement, and this is what Amiebly refers to intrinsic task. We have to love the subject, the project. We've got to kind of have a love affair with it. In other words, the right level of emotional engagement for ourselves to function at the optimum level of creativity. And she also, Amiebly also talked about the opposite of that, which is extrinsic task motivation. And what she's referring to here is that if the drive to be creative is coming from an external source, in other words, you might win a prize for this or you might get a first-class degree, that tends to drop our creativity as well. We need the right balance between internal motivation, a love of the subject, and a desire to fulfill an external goal, if you like. So it's a very fine balancing point there. On that subject of creative characteristics or cognitive skills, there's a list here. I'm not going to go through this list. I've mentioned tolerance for ambiguity. You will receive copies of these slides and also some other resources. So I don't want to unpack each one of these, but the one I will mention at this stage is that there isn't a strong correlation between intelligence and creativity. That is to say, you can have very bright people who don't seem to express their creativity. Of course, they have it, but they don't express it. And you can have people that don't perform well in terms of classical measures of intelligence who are hugely creative. So it's a kind of a different dimension to education, if you like. And in some ways, this is what's made it a challenge. We can't really teach creativity. All we can ever do is nurture it. And the easiest way to nurture it is by creating an environment in which it can flourish. And when I talk about making mistakes, that has to be included in that environment, that environment. In other words, excuse me, I've got a bit of a cough here. Just one sec. So if that environment doesn't penalize you for being wrong or for making mistakes, then there's more likelihood that great creative ideas will emerge. So again, there's a challenge in terms of how we conventionally assess in education and how we might assess creative thinking. I'm going to go on to the second definition now, and this is often muddled up with creativity. We often hear people say in the same sentence, oh, be creative or be innovative, as if they mean the same thing, and they don't. There is an overlap between them. So let's just look at this clunky definition of innovation. A connected process in which many activities from research through to support are coupled together in an integrated way for a common goal. What I'm really saying there is innovation is concerned with what you do, all of the activities, and this often involves other people, all the activities that need to be in place when an idea has been found. So when someone has an original idea, maybe yourself, another kind of skill needs to be brought to bear in order to bring that idea into an innovation. So then innovation is the tangible outcome of what was a creative idea earlier in time. And just to give you an example of this, if I ask you who invented the light bulb, most people would say, in answer to that question, Thomas Edison. And because he's known as the great inventor of this light bulb. But if we look at the history of the invention of the light bulb, it goes back about almost 80 years and before Edison, and he was the last person to invent it. And all of these other names there, most people have never heard of. And yet they all invented light bulbs and they all made light bulbs work, even if it was only for a few minutes. But the reason we remember Edison as the inventor is because he was also an innovator. He built on all those earlier ideas, but he made a light bulb that worked in a practical sense. He refined it, and so it worked for hundreds of hours. And he also got into a business relationship with an electricity distribution company, and he brought the light bulb out of the laboratory and into the factory, into the home, into the street. And so that is what I mean by innovation. The idea was there, but it needed different kind of effort in order for it to become known and to be applied in a useful way. And that is innovation. Now, with regard to research or educational projects, for example, when you're doing a project, you may start with a creative idea. But when you've written that report, after you develop the idea, that report is an innovation. It's a product of an idea that happened earlier. Now, academics don't often talk about academic papers or presentations as being innovation, but they are. They are the tangible outcome of an idea that started months earlier in time. I'm just going to try and now encapsulate creativity and innovation in a bigger picture, because in education, in recent terms, I work on a website, a social medium called Higher Education Creativity. And there's been a shift in the language in recent years. People are now talking more about imagination as well as creativity and innovation. And I want to, by means of a creative Venn diagram, try and show the difference between these three terms. And there's some philosophical implications in this, which I don't really want to go into at this stage, but you may wish to debate them afterwards. In a sense, we occupy two worlds. We live in the material world, and some philosophers would argue that material world is a fantasy, but I'm pretty sure that when I bump into a wall, that there's something out there. Now, the other world that we occupy is the world of the imagination, which is confined in our minds, if you like, or by the brain. And I want to suggest that, well, of course, creativity is a product of the imagination, but it's only part of the imagination. And there are certain what I call modalities of the imagination, which we can identify as potentials for creative ideas, for creative outcomes. The first of these is our ability to abstract. So we can see things in the material world, and we can abstract from those observations concepts that don't exist in the world. For example, I can look at a picture of the Earth and see that it's round. I can look at a beach ball and see that that's round. I can look at the moon and see that that's round. And eventually I can abstract from those observations a concept which is abstract, which is the concept of roundness. I know what I mean by roundness, and it doesn't have to be in the context of a circular object like a football or something. So that abstraction doesn't exist in the material world, it exists in my imagination. We have the same whole range of abstractions. For example, love. We can't find love in a physical sense, we can't find it in the material world. It's a concept we hold in our mind based on experience. The second modality is what I call visualization. And I want to broaden what we mean by visualization. We often think this is being able to imagine in your mind's eye, to see pictures. But visualization really refers to the ability to have sense experience of any of our senses. So we can imagine a smell, we can imagine a taste, we can imagine a sound. So that's a second form of a second modality of the imagination. The third one is the use of analogy and metaphor, which is, for example, I can see something in the world. For example, I can imagine electricity flowing down a wire, and I can, in my mind, I can invent an analogy that is like water flowing down a hose pipe. But it isn't. It's not. It's something I've constructed in order to try and understand how electricity flows. In fact, I can't see the electricity flowing in the wire, but I can see the water in the hose pipe. So I've constructed something to try and explain something, a phenomenon in the material world. The fourth one that I've mentioned, there is myths and stories. These are powerful entities for holding society, holding relationships together. We're all storytellers, but the story, it again, is a construction of incidents, experiences that we have in the world. And the final one I mentioned there is what I call, what's been known as the thought experiment, or what Einstein called the Gedanken, the ability to, it's a form of abstraction, the ability to imagine an experiment in your mind on what would happen. But again, it's happening purely in the imagination. Now, I want to argue that creativity is what connects those modalities with our operation in the material world. So they are original ideas through an interaction between observations in the real world and those creative modalities in the imagination. And I would place innovation here squarely in the material world, because this is involved with bringing creative ideas into action. They are an outcome, could be a product or a service or something like that. So I hope that kind of clarifies those terms, which are still being hotly debated, but that's, I hope this will continue the debate. Okay, let's just carry on with innovation. Let's just look at what drives innovation. In other words, an innovation is driven, of course, by creative ideas. These are the main drivers of innovation: the rise of global competition, which is a relatively new phenomenon because the world is much more connected electronically and in terms of transport and distribution, etc. So I can buy whatever I want from any part of the world now. It's not a problem. I'm not just confined to my own country. We also have economic boom and bust cycles. These are highly unpredictable and opposed to common sense. You would think that during a boom that we were more innovative, but it tends to be the opposite. When things are getting tough, that forces us to be more innovative, to come up with more creative ideas. We also have accelerating technological change. All three of these parameters, by the way, are mutually interacting all of the time. You can't separate any one of them. And just to give you a sense of accelerating technological change, if you look at the innovation period, that's how long it takes to, let's say, develop a new idea. Let's say it was a product. Someone's had a great idea for a vacuum cleaner, say, and how long does it take to make that into a product and then put it into the marketplace? That's the innovation period. And then the diffusion period is the number of years that it is in the marketplace, and it's still finding a lot of use. It's still an important application, if you like. Now, if you look at the 1970s, those periods were very long, 6 to 32 years in innovation, and diffusion, 15 to 20 years. If we now fast forward to current times, this has been compressed down to 1 to 5 years. When I worked in industry, I left in 2002. We were doing research on products. This was in optical communication, and they were in the market. They were actually in systems a year later. And I contrast that with when I was very much younger. I did a year as an apprentice in the aircraft industry, and I was working on an aircraft that had been designed 15 years earlier, and that was in the late 1970s. So I kind of experienced those, but that rapid compression of time in the development of technologies and ideas. The fourth contribution to innovation is what we call the open world. And this is the relatively recent breakdown or dissolution of traditional barriers to doing business or to achieving things. So it's very welcome, this. So we've got open access. This is being able to get hold of published papers. Anyone can now, you can now get hold of all the published work available without having to pay for it. It's free. Whereas the traditional model for publication was that it was based on a subscription model. So that excluded a lot of access to a lot of people. So that barrier is beginning to break down now. So anyone can get access to research, which is a great thing. We've got open source software, which is free. We've got open innovation, where companies are formed virtually in order to solve a problem. You get a team, a global team, people working together on a problem. And then when that problem has been solved, the company dissolves and they reform somewhere else. And we've got what we call open space meetings, which are much more liberating than formal meetings, where there are no rules, where everyone sets their own agenda. So this is a very welcome development, this openness that is really changing the way we innovate. And then the final one is somewhat more worrying, and this is the rise of global threats. We live in times now where we really need innovation to address these major problems that we're confronted with, for example, climate change and the pandemic. So those are the drivers of innovation. So and these continue to grow and grow. So there will never, ever be a shortage of the need for freshness, creative ideas, and so on. I now want to go on to in academia, we don't hear the word creative as much as we do critical thinking. There are two forms of thinking, and one of the greatest achievements of education is making us critical thinkers. We can analyze, we can reason, we can evaluate, we can write essays about subjects by applying these skills. But in actual fact, I want to make the case that critical inquiry is only half the story. But and you can actually teach critical thinking, but creative thinking is just as important, and you can't teach it. All you can ever do is nurture it. And I would, in that list, analyzing reasoning, this is often referred to as a list of critical thinking, but in fact, it's not. All of those skills require creativity as well. And if we just look at what we mean by these two forms of thinking, critical thinking is concerned with logic, logical solutions and reasoning, whereas creativity is concerned with ideas, the use of our intuition and our imagination. And in simple terms, Guilford in 1950 defined critical thinking as convergent thinking. This is a slight simplification, but it's useful for what I want to say now. And what he's referring there is to you have information coming in, that's the light beam, and you make the best use of that information and arrive at a decision or a focus or a conclusion. That is convergence. And more recently, Kahneman has referred to this as system two thinking in his book, Thinking Fast and Slow. The other side of this is divergent thinking that comes under creativity. So here, the light is now expanding out into the darkness to where we've not been. It's exploring new ideas. Again, that's Guilford's opposite to convergent thinking, that's divergent thinking. And Kahneman's version of this is system one thinking, which is allegedly a lot faster than system two. Now, I want to argue that these two forms of thinking cannot be separated. I mean, you can't do them both in parallel, but we do switch from one to the other constantly. They're just as equally important in the way we understand anything, in the way we learn, and in the way we do research. And I just want to show what happens if we exclude one of these by example. So if I said, let's just solve this problem here by reasoning alone, and I've chosen here something that should be familiar to everyone from high school, the quadratic equation, ax squared plus bx plus c equals naught. Now, when we're taught this, we're probably shown this final solution, x equals minus b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac over 2a. That's, household knowledge. that's the general solution. And in the textbooks, we may have been taught how to arrive at that solution. But often it's quite dismissed, easily dismissed. So it may be easily shown that, and there's the answer. All you need to worry about is this answer. But in actual fact, if you, and I would suggest this to people who are not mathematicians, but anyone who's familiar with that equation, try and derive that solution without referring to the solution. Try and derive that solution from that equation yourself on a piece of paper in a bit of spare time, and I can guarantee you'll run into trouble. And it's simply this. If you try and solve that just using reason alone, you will not probably solve it unless you can remember this little trick. But remembering is not the same as being creative. But this little trick here is a creative act. It's a technique called completing the square. If you manage to stumble across this method called completing the square, then that solution comes very easy. But if you don't, you can flounder and never get the answer. So what I'm arguing here is that just using reason to solve that problem will not give you the right answer. You need a creative input in order to do it. So we've switched from creativity to critical thinking. Now let's see what happens if we only rely on our intuition and we don't use reasoning and logic. And this is the problem here. Suppose 10% of the population have a virus and there is a test that is 90% effective. If everyone has been tested and a person taken at random has tested positive, what is the percentage chance that they actually have the virus? Now, most people, when you give them that problem, and just say, what does your intuition tell you is the answer to that problem? Most people will give you a very low value on the percentage that that person has the virus. But if you do a proper reasoned calculation, in other words, assume a population of say 100 people, and then you can work out exact numbers, you arrive at the fact that the chances that that person has the virus is 50%. And this goes against intuition. So what I'm trying to illustrate here is that whenever we are learning, we are constantly switching from creative thinking to critical thinking. This is how we progress ideas. And this actually brings me on now. Let me just check the time. I'm running fairly slow. And this brings me on to trying to understand progress in the context of creativity. We can understand it in the context of reasoning, but I want to look at it from the creative point of view. And to do this, I'm going to introduce the sigmoid curve, which may be familiar to some people, or the S curve. This S curve appears in all areas of research, whether that's in the arts or the sciences. It's a curve that represents something that grows from very small beginnings, and then the growth is accelerated, largely due to the response to the feedback in the environment into which it's growing. And then eventually it saturates. In other words, the feedback from the environment in which it's growing overwhelms the growth. So first of all, it assists it, and then it overwhelms it. And you find this in all areas. For example, population growths, this growth of cells on a leaf, chemical reactions, magnetic domains. It's a kind of a very common S curve. It's a very common curve known as the S curve. And here are two specific examples. The first one is fluorescence measurements in a polymerase chain reaction. And I've chosen that one because it really shows the classic S curve there. But this second one is interesting. This is much simpler. This is the height of a sunflower in centimeters versus the age of that sunflower in days. And that follows the classical S curve. Eventually, it stops growing. But the interesting thing about this paper in which this was published is the title. And this was Technological Forecasting and Social Change, Biologistic Growth, he referred to. And this chap who published this work was talking about the fact that he used this as an analogy to show that technology grew in the same way alongside social change. And if you look at the way just about anything changes in life, you can find that this S-curve kind of describes it quite well. So I've applied this S-curve. It's been used widely in industry for decades, and Silicon Valley they're always throwing S-curves at us, showing that, you know, with these they're a lot more complex, but they can make predictions on when you should start to invest more money in research for your next product because the previous one is reaching saturation, if you like. Now, I've just broadened this a bit further and suggested that just about anything that follows progress in this world over time can be modeled according to that S-curve. And if we take the example of research in any field whatsoever, if there's been a new breakthrough in a field, a new way of, for example, in literature, a new way of translating language, in art, a new way of interpreting the way we see, in science, a new technology, then it usually starts off very slowly. Maybe one or two people have had this breakthrough and they start to do research on it and they show that it's got benefit. It's starting to advance the knowledge base. We're gaining a bigger understanding of the field in which we're working. Then other people start to make use of that idea and apply it to their own world, to their own research. And then we get very rapid development. But eventually, because there isn't a theory or a method or a technology for everything, then eventually we reach a limit. In other words, applying this method, theory, or technique doesn't give us knowledge of everything, but it has advanced the field. And then when we reach that saturation, another development will occur, and that's the beginning of a new S-curve. The position of that second S-curve may vary considerably. It may be earlier in time or later. There could be delays and so on. So these curves represent progress in research, but they represent progress in just about everything, underpinned by new theory, new research methods, and new technology. And you can apply this in any discipline. It may not be a nice smooth curve, but it does tend to follow this. They're like mini revolutions, if you like. And that crossover from one curve to the other is known as a disruption because it's unpredictable and it starts a completely new growth curve altogether. And as I said earlier, the start point of that curve can vary depending on a lot of different factors. So let me just give you an example. We can apply these S-curves, which represent creative development over time, to paradigm shifts. For example, in science, in the 17th century, there was a scientific revolution that included people like Newton, Galileo, Kepler, etc., where they were beginning to understand space and time and could make predictions about the path that a mass would follow if it was falling in gravity, for example, falling under gravity. And this underpinning theory and knowledge of the universe held sway until the 20th century. So that curve grew and grew and grew, but then it started to saturate. I didn't mean to say it was wrong, but it started to be unable to answer all the questions that were being asked by the scientists. And in particular, Einstein started asking questions that challenged the Newtonian worldview. And he developed his theory of relativity in 1907. And that was the beginning of what we call a paradigm shift. The same thing happened at scale. For example, the classical worldview of the structure of matter underwent another paradigm shift, again, partly down to Einstein, with the development of quantum theory. So that was another paradigm shift. They're quite rare paradigm shifts, but in science anyway. So what we have there is the end of one cycle and the beginning of another one. But I just want to emphasize that the new cycle does not invalidate the earlier one. All we're saying here is the earlier one was right, but it wasn't completely right. And there may well be another paradigm shift on top of that second curve as well. If we now switch to the world of art, these curves are applicable at a much smaller scale. So I'm not looking at paradigm shifts here. I'm looking at art movements, different ways in which the artist sees the world. And over the last 120 odd years, we have seen a huge number of these art movements, if you like, and they all have a birth, a rapid growth, and a saturation. That doesn't mean to say that we haven't got impressionist artists in the 21st century. Of course we have, but they're not at the cutting edge. So artists are constantly trying to enable us or to draw our attention to different ways of seeing the world. And that is regarded as a progress, if you like. So those curves sit on top of each other. So this S curve can be applied very broadly, and it's very useful for tracking research, for understanding how something has developed and where it's going next. Now, the interesting thing about this from the point of view of creativity and more importantly, from the point of view of the individual, is that it doesn't look anything like that when we start to ask questions about our own creativity. What does progress look like? So if we take just a small part of that, one of those curves, and ask the question, what is it like doing research or doing this project over time? What does it look like? Well, it isn't a nice smooth curve. It's like this. We have a delay. We have an insight. That's an unpredictable creative outcome. We have another delay. We have another insight. So we're making some progress here. And then we have a delay. And then we have a setback when something didn't work. And then another delay, and so on and so on. So whilst I talked about a disruption going from one cycle to the next, when you look on a magnified scale at what it's like being an individual, being creative as an individual, it's disruptive all the time. It's not smooth. In actual fact, that smooth curve, the average curve there, can give us a wrong impression of how progress really happens. Because if we read a textbook, for example, we get that curve. We get an impression that it was one idea after another, and it was all carried out by very clever people who knew what they were doing. But that wasn't the case. If you look in history, it was much more like that very disruptive curve all along. So progress in anything we do, whether that's research or educating ourselves, is disruptive. It's a series of creative steps, delays, and setbacks. And the delays are partly due to the time it takes to solve a problem when we've been given one. It's what we call incubation time. And it's also partly due to how efficient we are at managing our time. So that's concerned with innovation. Creative steps represent original contributions. In research, that means that we could probably publish this work that we've developed. We've got a new idea that's worthy of publication. And setbacks are always useful. I said earlier that if you want to be creative, you've got to embrace mistakes. Well, we always learn from setbacks. They're incredibly useful. So we should never be put off by them. And I just want to put some real data on this, just to kind of prove a point. Now, in this graph, there is no record of setbacks because history tends to forget setbacks, but it does show what I'm talking about. You can see some disruptions there in this curve. This is a curve of progress. There are some step functions there that represent new ideas. And what this is the history of the world high jump. So we've got the height of the bar versus the year. And if we go back to the 1900s, everyone at the Olympics would be jumping in one way, and that was called the scissors. That was, at that time, that was the best way to jump over the bar. But then in about 1910, someone invented a different way of jumping called the Western roll, and the bar was raised, and that's that disruption, that kind of that inclusion there about 1910. And so, of course, everyone was learning the Western roll. And that continued to raise the bar. You see that slight curve growth, but then it saturates, it reached a limit. And then a new jump appeared called the straddle, and the bar was raised again. And then finally in the 1960s, Fosbury invented a completely different way of jumping, which was to jump over the bar backwards. And that resulted in a huge shift in the height of the bar. And of course, everyone followed Fosbury. Why would you use the straddle if you can jump higher with the Fosbury flop? So this is showing how four insights, four inventions, progressed the science of jumping over a bar. And what follows after an insight, when the invention was created, is refinement. This is what we call adaptive research, and this is what most research is. It's building on the back of an earlier idea. But it's interesting to ask the question, why did the bar continue to be raised after Fosbury's invention of the flop? And the reason for this is something I talked about earlier. It's about interdisciplinarity, because at that time there was a convergence with, there was a creation of sports science, a much better understanding of nutrition, technology, fitness, dare I say, drugs. But all of these other factors impacted on the science of jumping over a bar on the back of the invention. So you still can get enormous progress in that adaptive period of research that follows an invention.
Let me check the time.
Okay, I'm gonna finish this section, then we'll have a 5-minute break. I just want to finish with this slide. Well, there's probably a couple of more slides, but this one, again, some real evidence. This is based on some work I was involved in. I spent many years working in optical fiber communication, and I kind of looked at this from the point of view of these S-curves. And in actual fact, we could measure progress as a tangible number. It was how many bits of information could you get down an optical fiber per second. That was our measure. And the first research on this started in 1966, when Charlie Kao and George Hockham first proposed using light instead of electricity to communicate. And that started a very long and very slow S-curve that carried on until about the 1980s. We're still at the beginning of that S-curve here, but because there were so many problems to be solved in making this practical. This is, by the way, the invention of the internet, the physical infrastructure of the internet. But by the 1980s, they'd advanced all this technology to actually make it practical. It was now an innovation. And that's the earlier S-curve of the competing technology, which is copper cables, and that saturated in the 1980s. So it was no longer practical for communicating over long distances. What followed after that was a whole series of these S-curves, these different developments, all aiming at trying to progress in terms of this bit rate, the efficiency of our optical communication systems. And many other technologies were involved in this that kind of combined. So it was a multidisciplinary activity, glass chemistry, cable design, packaging and so on, laser design. And there were also many technologies that span out, spinned off, startups and new companies, new ideas that came out of that technology. But I've only shown this just to demonstrate in practical terms that S-curve is highly applicable to the real world. And my last slide before we have a break is just to emphasize this. I talked about this in the context of doing research, but I want to suggest, and this is something for you to debate, that education and research have a lot more in common than we think. If we look at that formal historical curve of research, we know now that it's disruptive all the way, but we tend only to report on the breakthroughs and the progress. We don't talk about setbacks or delays. So we get an impression that the curve is carried out by, is a superhuman achievement, error-free predictability and certainty. But if you study textbooks, you find exactly that. So that's what you would find in research papers. But if you study textbooks, you will find the same thing. There is no mention of mistakes when ideas were being formed. All of those textbooks, all the content came out of the research that was carried out in history, during history. It's a kind of a compressed version of all the research, but expressed in a way that it all looks very joined up, very coherent. There's no mistakes, there's no delays, there's just ideas. And when, again, I talked about research looking like this, well, I want to argue that education looks like that as well. And so that curve represents not just how research progresses, how we solve problems with a project, it also represents how we learn. We have delays, we have insights where we understand what was expressed in that book, and we have setbacks where we didn't understand it or it didn't work out as we planned. And in the context of education, a big idea is what's called in education a threshold. And it's all very well having a great idea, but trying to explain that great idea to someone who's trying to understand the subject is another story altogether. And this is where education has a challenge. How do you get your students over those thresholds? And I'm going to take a break now because we've had over an hour. I'll continue how we get over those thresholds in this next slide. But let's just have a 5-minute comfort break, and I'll see you back here at 9:15. We're trying to assimilate those ideas. And so we reach these, what were insights to the creator, but when we reach those, these are conceptual challenges that we've got to try and understand. And these have been referred to as thresholds. And as a teacher and a learner, it's a challenge to get over those thresholds. It might be an enjoyable experience if you're the one who creates that insight, but when you're trying to understand the conceptual aspect of this, it's a problem. And this has been studied. And I just want to quote from some research here. It says, a threshold concept is likely to involve forms of troublesome knowledge. David Perkins defines this as that which appears counterintuitive, alien, or seemingly incoherent. From this view, mastery of a threshold concept can be inhibited by the prevalence of a common sense or intuitive understanding of it. Getting students to reverse their intuitive understandings is also troublesome because the reversal can involve an uncomfortable emotional repositioning. Now, that's the reference there. But there are remedies for this. In other words, what I'm saying here is that we don't all understand everything. You know, no matter how bright we are at our subject, we will embrace concepts that we find hard to understand. This happens to everyone, no matter how experienced we are. And the remedy is this. It's called recursiveness and excursiveness. In short, there is no simple passage in learning from easy to difficult. Mastery of a threshold concept often involves messy journeys back and forth across conceptual terrain. And in other words, we're back to what I was saying earlier. When we're trying to understand something, we have to keep switching from a critical appraisal of the idea to then launching our own creativity. We've got to be creative with our own understanding of these ideas. We can't just get there by a critical, logical, stepwise approach. We need to embrace creativity as well. And one technique to do that is called, this is a Middle Eastern educational technique that we don't hear a lot about in the West, which is called the scatter technique, but it's probably got another name in our country. But basically, when we reach those thresholds that we're struggling with, the best remedy is to get a variety of sources to, don't just take one person's interpretation of the idea. Look at books in which that particular subject is part of a wider interdisciplinary study, because often you get much more clarity in those things, in those texts, rather than ones that are highly specialized. So again, this is having a creative attitude to understanding your own conceptual difficulties, and that is the remedy for doing that. Okay, I'm now, having reviewed the material I've got, this third point, methods, tools and techniques, because time is a little bit against me, what I'm only going to cover some bits of this, so the essential parts, but I can do that here because I will be sending you a resource that will explain that you can actually use, you can use it in practice, but it also explains a fair bit of what I would have normally been talking about here. So if you don't mind, when I reach the point, I'm going to jump about three or four slides and then I will be able to finish on time and you will receive that resource separately. But before I talk about methods, tools and techniques, so this is very much practical side of this lecture, I want to draw your attention to this. This was a study carried out by Adobe, the software company, and they were curious to find out what was the difference between a software company that embraced creativity and one that didn't. And they did a survey with about 60 different software companies, asking them to report on how much the company itself, you know, the environment in which people are working, encourage creativity in the workforce, or whether they just relied on individuals coming up with ideas randomly. And one of the conclusions from that report is this: asking employees to be more creative won't change anything without incorporating creative tasks, tools, and techniques into business strategy and execution. So in other words, and I've heard this said many times, you know, someone will say, oh, just be creative, as if it was some kind of internal switch that we can volitionally, you know, it's our own volition, we can just flick, and we can't. And this is the importance of this section, which, as I said, is available as a handout. We really need tasks, tools and techniques, frameworks, in order to bring our creativity to bear, because you can't just assume that giving someone a problem will stimulate their creativity. So this is the background to why I've got this section in on methods and tools, but I am only going to cover bits of this. So the first thing is, I've mentioned this earlier, all these frameworks I'm talking about tend to look at two modes of thought: divergent thinking associated with imagination, new ideas, new questions, and convergent thinking is about critical thinking, idea selection, and answers to questions. And one of the kind of basic tools of creativity is what's called brainstorming. I'm sure that's a familiar term. This was first developed by Osborne and Parnes in the 1950s. And they came up with this very important rule: when you want to develop new ideas, it's so important to diverge first and converge only when you've got sufficient ideas. Now, if you want to find truth, we mix divergence with convergence. If you observe any kind of debate, academic debate, we diverge and converge and so on in a random way. If you want to find great ideas, it's so important to apply this rule: suspend convergent thinking until afterwards. And this is that was the golden rule of Osborne and Parnes. And they, and when I talk about brainstorming, I'm referring to a group of people here, all trying to solve a problem together by coming up with ideas. And they came up with these guidelines: if in divergent thinking, suspend judgment, go for as many ideas as you can, combine and improve the ideas, and seek wild ideas. Often when people brainstorm, they don't have any rules, and it's so important to have some guidelines. When it comes to convergent thinking, you do this only afterwards when you've got lots of ideas. And if you've got a huge number of ideas, then you cluster similar ones first and compare the clusters. It's important to be decisive here. Check the objective, that you haven't gone off at a tangent. That often happens in a brainstorm. And remind yourself you're seeking novelty. So these rules are really important when you're working as a team. Now onto the frameworks. I've just given a snapshot here of a few frameworks. I do believe in any kind of project, it's so important to adhere to a framework. You don't need to be rigorous, but the framework is there as a reference, and you can kind of pick it up and put it down as you need to. But if you have got no framework, you can end up just going around in circles. I just want to mention one or two of these. A lot of them are based on Osborne and Parnes' work in the 1950s in America. But the KJ method is, I'm sure, is more familiar to you in Japan. And this is something I learned about recently. I went on a course on the KJ method, and I found it really, really interesting. And in fact, I now teach this, or part of it, to my students when I'm teaching. It's particularly useful in writing, developing writing skills as well. And that is quite different to these other techniques. Anyway, the method that I'm going to skip through very quickly and miss out some of this material, I've reduced these very complex creative problem-solving techniques to three steps. Each step has got a diamond, which represents diverge, followed by converge. And this is how we solve. And this can be applied to any kind of problem-solving. It's generic. It doesn't matter which discipline you're working in. If you want to solve a problem, if you want to improve your ability to do research, it's so important to break it down into a set of tasks. And this is one such structure that allows that. So what's the problem? Diverge, then converge. Where are the ideas? Diverge, converge. How do we make it happen? Diverge, converge. And these are all tools that you can use, which I will supply you with after this event. So that's why I'm not going to go in a lot of detail on this. I will mention this. There's a recent growth in what we call design thinking, which appears at first sight to be different to creative problem solving. But I want to argue, and this was developed at Stanford in the USA, and I want to argue that they're actually the same. And I've mapped onto design thinking, I've mapped from design thinking onto my creative problem solving process here by the color schemes. And I just make this note that the word empathize in design thinking is a soft term for identifying a challenge in creative problem solving. Many people in engineering and design, for example, would not recognize the term empathize as part of a process. So that's just in case you were familiar with design thinking. It does relate very closely to the Osborne Pound's creative problem solving process as well. So I'm not going to spend much time on this because of time constraints. And just to say, you will receive copies of all of these handouts and instructions on how to carry out this process. And so I'm going to quickly go through this because this is that you'll receive all this information. And so you can study this at your own leisure. The bit I do want to concentrate on is, because we're talking about creativity, is this second stage on finding ideas. And I want to show that there are three different forms of idea generation. Often when we want ideas, it doesn't matter what area we're working in, we use our default method for finding ideas is called thinking by association. So what does this remind me of? And this is the first of three forms of idea generation. And it's immediate and continuous. So we look at our problem and say, what does this remind me of? And we come up with, if you like, a mind map, but we come up with immediate associations. And I want to argue that that's great to start, but if you stop there, you're going to miss lots of really important ideas. So there are two other types of idea generation. The second one is the use of actual idea generation tools. And I'm going to describe a really useful tool for anyone involved in higher education. It's really a powerful tool. And this can take a different time frame, hours to days. And this is prompted by asking the question, what if? And then there's a third form of idea generation, which I've called insights, which can be days to months. And this is unprompted. This is what we call eureka moments. And the important message about a eureka moment is, if you want to get great eureka moments, you know, sudden insights, it's best not to resolve the problem. You may have got ideas from those earlier techniques, but don't draw a line under the problem. If you continue to keep the problem open or the challenge open, then in the back of your mind, you will still be processing it. And usually in unusual circumstances, a great idea can appear that is better than anything you came up with before. So, but obviously you can't wait months when you're doing a project, but you can allow in the development of the project the possibility of introducing ideas that arrive later. So this is the most important idea generation tool, in my view, for working in higher education. And this is what I call transformation, or what if. This is quite old. I'm not saying this is new, but what's often surprising about a lot of the work, earlier work on creativity, is that it hasn't yet found widespread use. So you may be familiar with it or you may not, but I just want to go through it here. And I'm going to try and illustrate these transformations with examples. So there are seven transformations. There are seven ways in which you can look at an existing problem or the ideas in an existing solution, say, and you can say to yourself, I want new ideas. What if I substitute one part of this current solution, one method in this current solution, one process in this current solution? What if I substitute that for something different? So, for example, the Airbus 350 XWB is the first aircraft that has substituted the aluminium alloy wings with composite fibers. So that's a material substitution. And in the art world, Archimboldo, who was an Italian artist, created these amazing faces where he substituted the features of the face with fruit and vegetables. That's going back to the 16th century. The second thing you can say is, what if I combine an idea here with an idea that's over there? What if I combine functions, methods, or materials? Where does that take me? Well, some recent work by Dr. Ejiro Miyako at the Japanese Advanced Institute of Science and Technology did some very novel work where he was researching on how pear trees are pollinated. Now, normally the pollination is carried out by bees, but because there's a bit of a shortage of bees at the moment due to climate problems, he was looking at a novel way of pollinating the trees in a different way. Now, to do it artificially, you use a brush, but it can take a long, long time to cover a whole orchard. And he saw his son playing with a bubble gun in the park, and he suddenly had this idea of, what if I combine the soap solution with pollen, pear tree pollen, and just simply blow the bubbles up into the trees? And this worked beautifully, and he got something like a 95% yield by this technique. So that's a great example of combining two ideas to get something else. if we go into the world of art, Picasso combined the seat of a bicycle with the handlebars and got something bigger than the sum of the parts, which was known as the bull. And Marc Chagall combined the shape of the human torso with that of a cello and made it all into one. The third one we can say is, what if I adapt? What could be adapted here? What other ideas does this suggest? Excuse me. And I've got two examples here. The first is the microwave oven. The microwave oven, or microwave cookery, was an adaptation from radar research. A chap called Percy Spencer was working on a magnetron, a radar transmitter, when he had a bar of chocolate in the vicinity, and he noticed that the chocolate bar started to go soft because the radiation had interacted with the water molecules in the chocolate. And he suddenly had an insight, thinking, wow, I've got a great way of cooking here. So he adapted radar technology into cookery. And in the world of art, I've got an example here, Andy Goldsworthy, who goes out into nature. He doesn't take any paints or any easels or brushes. He simply adapts what he sees in nature and turns it into an art installation. So that's the first three. The next one is modify by asking, what if I scale this idea up, this existing idea, or what if I scale it down? What if I replicate it? What could I modify with this idea? And the examples I've got here are micro-machine silicon. These are very scaled down versions of machines, machine mechanisms that are in the real world scale. Here they've been scaled down and made etched into silicon devices. In the world of art, another example from technology would be the scaling up of 3D printing. It started off as modestly sized polymer 3D printing to make artifacts. And now we've got huge gantries of concrete that are basically 3D printing houses. So that's another. So creativity is driven by these seven transformations. In the world of art, Klaus Oldenburg scales up everyday objects. And we've got an example here, his installation of a match in a gallery. And on the other extreme in the world of art, Willard Wigan does very tiny sculptures. And this is one of William Shakespeare that fits into the eye of a needle. The next example I've got is, what if we put something to another use? What else could this be used for? What could be done with it? And the example I've got here is George de Mestral, who took a walk in the woods in Switzerland many years ago. And when he came back, he noticed that his dog had got these cockle burrs on the dog's fur when it had passed through the undergrowth in the trees. And he was curious to wonder how these cockle burrs had attached to the dog's fur, because they're seeds, and that's the way those seeds are dispersed through the woods. And what he did, he looked under a microscope and he discovered that these seeds had tiny hooks on them. And so he said to himself, what if I substitute the material, and what if I put this to another use? And that was how Velcro was invented. Looking at other examples here, James Marshall was quite concerned when he saw the rubbish left behind after a Glastonbury music concert. He saw tents and sleeping bags, and he put all of the material to another use and designed fashions from those materials. And another example of put to other uses is the Rio Olympics in 2016, where they didn't have a very big budget for the opening and closing ceremonies. But what they did was highly creative. They put to other uses carnival materials and artifacts and transformed those into what became the opening splendor, you know, wonderful opening ceremonies. So that's another transformation. And the next one is eliminate. You ask the question, what could be removed from this? What could be streamlined? What's unnecessary? What's wasted? And the example in technology I've got here is this very interesting invention called the Eco Tap. And this is a tap that has a very fine spray of water. And the important thing is it gives you the experience of washing your hands, that your hands feel very wet and you're able to wash your hands. But the actual volume of water that's coming out of that tap is much lower than in a conventional tap. So this is playing into the fact that our experience of things is different to the actual reality of the thing. So we don't need much water to feel that our hands are wet. In fact, when we use an ordinary tap, most of the water is wasted. So this is a great invention for places where there is water's in short supply. In the world of mathematics, we eliminate in software, this is a fast Fourier transform, is a brilliant example of elimination where many, many repeated calculations were removed, only carried out once in a very efficient way in this algorithm. And in the world of art, there was an exhibition at the Haywood in London recently where there was no art. It was the ultimate eliminate. It was just a series of blank canvases, and there was an invisible labyrinth and a plinth with no sculpture on it. So there seems to be some artistic benefit in nothing as well. So, and the final one is reverse. We ask the question, what could be inverted? What if I turn this inside out? What if I turn it upside down? What's the opposite? And the examples I've got here are in the world of architecture, the inside out building, this is the Lloyd's building in the City of London, where all of the services are on the outside. That's the lifts, the water, the electricity, and so on. And so there's a lot more space on the inside. So it's an inverted building in a sense. Bach came up with a number of musical short compositions that were actual mirror images of each other. These were called Bach's inventions. The inverted opal is a three-dimensional array of spheres, silica spheres, And these have got some potential for optical communication at very small scales. And some guys that were researching this were curious about what an inverted opal would look like. And what they did was they dipped the conventional opal, as this is a synthetic opal, into a polymer. When that had set, they then etched out the spheres. So we have the negative space of the opal. So that's an inverted opal. And in the world of art, I've got this example of Andrew Wyeth, who did the unconventional approach of painting a portrait. Instead of the model looking at him, he asked her to look away. And that resulted in this rather sublime image of, there's a sense in which we're seeing it through the eyes of the model themselves. Okay, stop me when you want, Johnny, because I know I've got a question time to add on to this, and I've still got a few slides to do. So that's you'll get a copy of this. That's a series of those prompts. And I just want to mention this with regard to education, that there's a big challenge about how do we assess creativity. This is from the point of view of teachers, but it's also useful for students. How do you assess creativity in education? Well, one of the problems with assessment is we often muddle talent up with creativity. Now, talent is the ability to do things well, and creativity is the ability to do things differently. And it's so important to be able to see the difference. And so my answer to this is, if we use that tool, that transformation tool, in reverse, we can use this as a means of assessment. In other words, suppose you've done a project, or a teacher is assessing a project, and they're trying to give it an assessment in terms of creativity. All we simply do is say, is there evidence in this project of substitution or combination or existing combination of existing ideas? So we can use that tool as a assessment of creative thinking. Now, I don't know what you want me to do, John. I've still got a few slides, and I know you wanted a question time, so I will, think, of course.
I was just thinking, because it is sort of 22. So why don't we see if people have got questions? I think that's a really good idea, because it's getting on, and I certainly know I have questions, and I think people may have things that they want to ask, or particularly a specific context. So if you're okay, I think it would be good to have an opportunity.
Yeah, I'm sorry, I overdid it, really.
No, not at all. It was completely fascinating, anyway. But I think it would be really good to open up to see if people would like to ask anything. So
sure.
So let me open things up then. So please feel free to ask questions. You know, use the raise hand functionality if you want to just ask a question live. You can post a question in the chat. Or if you're nervous about asking a question, you can send your question to Cecilia, and Cecilia can ask it for you. So please do go ahead, and remember that if you're using the Japanese channel, you can ask your questions in Japanese and have them translated. So are there any questions or comments?
Stunned silence.
I had a question actually that I really wanted to ask, and you were talking there was a lot of things, so I actually have lots of questions, but one of them that you talked about was this recursiveness and excursiveness idea. And this idea that essentially one of the ways I thought about that is that we don't learn in a linear sense, but we do tend to teach in an entirely linear sense, right? So, a lecture course or a program usually has, particular, I mean, maybe less so in certain areas, but certainly if you take a scientific subject, you're always progressing through the knowledge and building every week. And that seems to map rather badly, onto the way we learn, in that some things might be simple and it's easy to follow along in the linear sense. But other things, you probably need longer periods. So I just wondered if you had any experience or thoughts on that, on strategies in the classroom for, encouraging the development of, you know, allowing space for difficult concepts to have time, whereas simple concepts to move on and so forth. I just wondered what you thought.
Yeah, no, it's a really good point. In fact, I was, I was going to mention this in a couple of slides, but I took them out at the last minute. A really important thing, certainly with regard to science and engineering, one really good way, in my view, to overcome those thresholds, because you're absolutely right. You know, textbooks are, as I was saying as well, and you said, are compressed versions of years and years of research. And if you get into the mind of the person that did that research, that then ultimately got compressed into a page of text, how on earth can do you expect that student to understand? You know, because they that an example I would quote here is the derivation of Maxwell's equations. Now, if you look at those, it's all vector analysis. It can be dispatched in one page of text, but if you look at the historical perspective of that, it was 50 years of research. And my argument is that when you get those ideas that are quite hard to take in, if you go in, sprinkle a little bit of history into the actual formal teaching and say, well, actually, when Maxwell developed these equations, the truth of the fact is there's only four final vector equations, but when Maxwell developed them, there was 20. And if you show, because you couldn't have arrived at four just like that, but if you said, well, if you look at what Maxwell was doing, initially he had 20 because he used each X, Y, and Z coordinate separately. If they were presented to the student and then showed how that was then compressed into three-dimensional equations, I believe that you're then getting into the mind of Maxwell himself and leading the student along that historical route that might then just get them over that threshold a lot easier. Now, obviously, you can't turn a science lecture into a history lecture, but there's just occasions where reflecting on the struggle. In fact, it's all about, in a sense, humbling these great thinkers and just showing that, you know, for example, Millikan simply wouldn't believe that there was the charge on the electron was what he was. It took him 10 years to accept it. And I think it's bringing that human element into these great thinkers, showing that they were just the same as them, and that there were smaller steps that were needed in order to get to that big step, even if it's only an emotional sense that, you know, that you don't need to go into a great deal of facts, but just to sort of say that this is not easily arrived at, and these were maybe some intermediate steps that might help you along the way. Obviously, it requires a lot more input into the preparation of the lectures, and it's hard enough to get what you have to get across in an hour. But that's just one thought about that.
But I actually think that's interesting, because I think thinking beyond the subject there, the idea, I think giving lots of examples of the fact, you know, of this illusion of what we have due to the condensed nature of it is something that's very useful to dispel. But I also in my own personal experience in recent years, I found that one of the greatest learning tools now is YouTube, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
And it goes back to what you're saying, because you can watch 100 videos like on the same subject. Each with a slightly different viewpoint and a take, and very often not too long. So you can watch a lot of them in a short period of time.
You're absolutely right.
And at some point, one of them suddenly hits you. You're like, I get it. Add that. Yeah. Whereas five of them might have passed you by. So you're
absolutely right. In fact, I had an experience of that myself recently. I was trying to derive, I do this as a masochistic hobby, trying to derive equations. Like I did that quadratic thing, I could not crack it, you know. And, I've tried deriving equations that I learned years ago, thinking I understood them, and I tried doing them from first principles. I couldn't. And I was trying to work out why this factor of a third always appeared in the calculations of the volume of solid objects, like, and I couldn't find where this third came from, you see. I could intuitively see it. And, you know, like if you take a pyramid, it's a third of a cube. And anyway, I went onto YouTube and I saw about, as you say, dozens of videos. And I came across one and it was perfect. Really explained it absolutely clearly, where a lot of them were just saying, well, it's, you know, intuitively, it's a third of the volume. But this guy derived it, and it was just so amazingly clear. And that's what I meant by that scatter. Look broadly across tech, yeah. not just the one. And, you know, and scatter your inquiry in conversations with other people as well. And you build up, it's almost like you get multiple impacts. And when you get multiple impacts, you get that sudden, every now and again, they suddenly all add up. And that's when you cross that threshold.
But again, it requires time and space, doesn't it? You know, to do these things. That's one of the, because so like, for example, in the University of Tokyo, students take a very large number of courses at the same time. I think that can work against, you know, providing enough room to explore things rather than, it tends to focus you down the thing of, I must know this, I'll learn it this way, I'll focus on what's necessary. Whereas truly understanding things, you know, is really helped by this, as you said, the scatter approach, where you get as many different perspectives.
I remember I was trying to understand something to do concerned with creativity a while ago, some work by Margaret Bowden, and I couldn't really get a grasp on it. And I then came across a book which was anthropological. It was a study of ancient human beings. It was about how creativity developed. And in that, there was a chapter by Margaret Bowden who'd written it for this different audience and, you know, weren't specialists in this field. And when I read that, it was so easy. That's why I said go to multidisciplinary texts as well, where, you know, it's not the main emphasis of the thing you're trying to understand. And you'll find someone has explained it in very simple terms that are so easy to grasp. But what you said about lots of subjects, I mean, that's got a real benefit, of course, hasn't it, from the other creative perspective?
Absolutely. I think
of crossing boundaries, you know, so it's a bit of a trade-off there. So. Yeah.